Oh, I have. I've gotten into trouble with Bruce Buffer before.
Oh, let's hear it. Let's hear it. We talked about what was it? Tea to Green. You did the Tea to Green.
Yeah.
Show.
Yeah. Well, I produced it. You know, basically sidekicking. Common Man is our big golf guy at the Fan. And I've played with him a couple, maybe like around a dozen times in my life, which is privileged. There does need to be some kind of deal down the line where they can, when the PGA can kind of evolve and do kind of the fun, different ideas that LIV is doing. For me, it's like the importance and like the gravity of having like major tournaments and like the Ryder Cups, President's Cups, Players Championships, TPCs, all that stuff. Like, for me, like, that's what draws me to the PGA and like keeps me coming back. But it's definitely not the like old man, outdated rules of the game that brings me back.
There is a podcast brewing that's about to take over podcasting for good. The only podcast that you are going to need to tune into day in, day out is the Member Guest Podcast.
If I can hit it down the middle of the fairway, that's great. But again, with the driver right now, the driver sucks.
John Daly, and you're listening to the Member Guest Podcast. Rip it, rip it.
Mr. Ryan Donaldson, welcome.
What's going on, Jordan? Nice to meet you.
Yeah, this is our first time ever actually meeting each other, even though I've heard Andrew talk about you for years. I like to give people a little quiz. Can you name the four people in our intro? Did you listen to all of it?
I heard John Daly.
Yeah, that was the easy one because he said his name.
That was the easy one. Oh, man. I was not paying that close. I was appreciating the intro, but I wasn't paying attention to who the voices belong.
We've had somebody get three of four. So the first one's Robbie Berger from Bob Does Sports.
Okay.
You know that guy?
I know the name.
Yeah, he's like Fat Perez.
Oh, okay. You know, yeah,
those
course.
Guys. Yeah, so Bob Does Sports is like the main dude from there.
Sure.
He's like a cameo legend. And the second one is DeChambeau when he's talking about his driver that sucks.
He's off to a good start today.
Yeah, he is. We got the Masters on too. What is it, day one? They started a little late,
I think. They did. About a two-hour delay.
Yeah, he is playing good. And then the third is Bruce Buffer.
Okay.
The UFC announcer.
Oh, I have I've gotten into trouble with Bruce Buffer before.
Oh, let's hear it. Let's hear it.
This is a great place to start because we were just talking off the air, and we were talking about KFAN, my days at the Fan a little bit, and right before I left, there was a day when Zach Halverson, a mutual White Bear Lake boy.
Oh, yeah. Go Bears.
He was off that day, but it was a Friday. They were going to do the initials game on the power trip. And every Friday, they usually record a brand new open to say, you know, what initials game it is, whether it's initials game 450 or 456.
Oh, sure. Yep.
But I went out of the way, and I kind of did like a whole open with the let's get ready to rumble bit.
Okay. And you used Buffer?
And I used the Buffer, like, whole song, like, from Jock Jam's CD, yeah, like, with the whole open and intro in there. And I got the station into a little bit of trouble with Bruce Buffer's guys.
He picked that up,
yeah,
huh?
His lawyers or something picked it up, and we worked it all out. Everything was fine. I didn't get, like, fired or anything for it, but I created this initials open, like, let's get ready to initials! Yeah, Bruce Buffer's guys got a hold of it, and they gave my boss a call. Yeah,
that's kind of like a pat on the back, though, if you do something like that, and then it gets noticed by somebody that big.
I guess. I did not mean to leave the Fan on that note, but that's how it went down. It was pretty funny. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. That. God, who was it? Oh, it was. We were just talking about MJ from Unreal, who was also on the pod a couple episodes ago. But the first T-shirt he ever made. Actually, maybe not the first because he did some like jerseys and stuff. But the first one I bought from him was this light blue just T-shirt. And it said Beauty on the front. But it was in the font of Bauer. You know, Bauer Hockey?
Oh, sure.
Kind of had that like sleek, almost like italicized, whatever that term is. Like,
yeah.
Kind of sideways. He looked just like that. And I don't think he sold a ton of them, but enough where Bauer picked that up.
Okay, nice.
And they like send. He has like the cease and desist from Bauer. Like... I know it doesn't say Bauer, but it looks just like Bauer. And if you don't stop selling those, like, we're going to come after you.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, shit.
No doubt. Yeah. You got to be careful these days.
Yeah.
People are out there.
They are. I thought I could have swore there was something in like the media industry, though, where aren't there rules around what you can and can't use? Like, can't you can like play other people's music and stuff, but like, where's the line drawn between what you're able to do and what you're not able to do?
Yeah. There was always a little bit of a gray area on talk radio stations where I was, because we could play songs basically anywhere outside of like the officially licensed version of that song. So if we recorded a song like into our system, we were allowed to play the music to a certain degree. You can play the bumper music as you bump back from like a commercial break, or you're going out to a commercial break. But the things have changed a little bit, like where the licensing now has gotten way more serious. They're cracking down on it more. I think I've heard guys on the Power Trip mention it. Like, they're not allowed to play more than 25 seconds of an officially licensed song anymore, regardless of how it was put into our system. Back in the day, there was a little bit of a loophole around it where, like, the music brands, the music stations, they get all of their songs out of basically a certain category within our system. If you record and dump into a different category in the system, then you can kind of make a little bit of a loophole. But that no longer exists. So the rules have changed a little bit. I've been out of the radio game for like a year and a half, but.
Oh, it's been that long. Yeah. So what, we should probably give a little bit of background about, about you before we get rolling. But, yeah, why don't you just talk about it? Because a lot of people know your name from KFAN, at least people that are local listeners. I don't know how far our audience spans these days.
Sure.
Last time I looked at our stats, we'd had like a couple people outside of the United States. Yep. I think shout out to India. We have a couple in India. Nice. But other than that, like most people come from Minnesota, so they'll probably know the name Ryan Donaldson from
the band.
Yeah. We call it a global audience.
I love it.
Yeah.
You're international.
Bad. Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. I mean, I grew up here in Minnesota. We've got a couple of mutual buddies from our younger days.
Shout out Andrew Ross.
Shout out to Andrew Ross today. Him and I went to school basically from second grade through high school together. So we're really good buddies.
So you're a Blake kid.
I'm a Blake kid.
Congrats.
Thank you. Made it through the hard private school hallways. Yeah, for sure. I went to University of Arizona for college. Loved my time out there a little bit too much. It was a fun school.
I've heard great things.
Yeah.
I love Arizona, by the way.
Yeah. Arizona's always been kind of a second home for me, and that's what brought me out there. Like, my grandma had a house, and so when we were little, when she was still around, my family would basically go out there every Christmas and do a week out in Arizona. And so I fell in love with the desert from when I was a child and just wanted to go back out there, have an excuse to get back out there and kind of make it a second home. And yeah, so I went to U of A for my college experience down in Tucson and absolutely loved it. But being a Minnesota boy and an absolute like hardcore Minnesota sports fan, I wanted to get back home since I grew up here and be close to that scene. And I wanted to get into sports radio when I graduated college. So I started an internship in 2009 at the Fan and basically got hired on there shortly after. Was an assistant producer for 13 years up until about a year and a half ago. Took on a second role as well as a promotions director when I was there for my final 5 years. So that's kind of, I was kind of handling two different gigs at the same time. Loved my experience there. I wouldn't change any of it. But, yeah, I wanted something different, so I left about a year and a half ago. Been doing kind of my own thing, freelance voice acting at home, out of my own home studio. Not as cool as this one because I don't have a
Well, this isn't a studio, to be fair. It's a simulator that we've turned into a studio because we had nowhere else to record when we wanted to start this
thing. I mean, no better place to record than somewhere where you can hit drives.
All we do is move the chairs out of here and turn on the computer and, you know, we could be teeing off at Augusta. Although on the simulator it's called, what do they call it? Georgia Golf Club, because like Augusta's very, you know, with their rights and stuff.
Yeah.
So it's called Georgia Golf Club. And then you see that it's in Augusta, Georgia, and you click it open and you're playing Augusta.
That's amazing.
Yeah, they have enough flyovers of it, and it's the one that gets updated the most because people want, like, you know, the most recent version of Augusta.
Sure.
So like you'll see that it was probably updated a couple weeks ago. It's pretty sweet.
That's badass. I mean, hopefully, like, you know, in the and like I mentioned in the radio industry, like the music licensing people don't catch on to the Augusta and Georgia Golf Club.
Whoever does it, there's got to be, you know, some loophole, you know, like they they take the flyovers from Augusta and then they change like one or two things, sure. You know, that you just wouldn't ever notice. Like they take out a tree somewhere and they're like, yeah, this is
totally different.
Yeah. It's way different. It's not
the same course.
Not even the same. Yeah. It's probably somewhere along those lines.
Yeah. That's awesome. And obviously, we're talking now because I love the game of golf. So that's kind of my other thing. I joined Golden Valley in 2019. I grew up around that club. My dad has been there for a while. I was, a caddy there in my teenage days. So, carried a lot of bags in my days, got a lot of miles on these legs, a lot of sore shoulders from those days and a lot of not so great tips after those rounds, but we battled through.
I've got a question for you as a former caddy.
Sure.
That I would assume you didn't caddy for any professionals. Like you just did it at Golden Valley.
Yeah, okay. just members at the club. So Rocco's a member there. Rocco Mediate's a member, but I never got to carry his bag.
Okay, so here's my question. So as you can see, I have staff bags.
Okay.
Andy, my co-host, couldn't be here today, gives me flack for it because like he has a carry bag. And my thought process is I've got like one of those electric carts and I like to walk. I really do, but I hate carrying. It doesn't matter if it's a staff bag or just a normal bag. Like I don't want something on my shoulder. I don't want to have to carry around a 20, 30 pound bag for 4.5 hours.
Yeah.
He's like, well, what about your caddies? I'm like, well, that's kind of what caddies do. And like, I'll take the heavy stuff out of my staff bag, but like that's what they do. They carry the bags. So my question to you would be, one, did you ever have to carry a staff bag? And two, if you did, were you really pissed when you had to?
I didn't, honestly.
So
I
don't, nobody else is an asshole with staff bag. Well, bags, what you're saying.
Also, like, did they even make bags like that back in, like, you know, like 20 years? Because
I'm sure they did, but I doubt it was as popular as it is today for call it the general golfer.
Exactly. Like you would see pros with those bags back in the day.
Yeah.
But it would be pretty rare that you would see a member walking around with something that
and
fancy.
And then the other thing I always say is like, it's basically a cart bag. Cause nowadays there's three versions of a bag, right? There's like, well, maybe even four. There's kind of like the Sunday carry bag that, you know, is super small. And then there's just a normal carry bag. And then there's a cart bag and then a staff bag. I'm like, it's not really that different than a cart bag other than like being a different shape, but cart bags are pretty standard. Nobody complains about those.
Yeah, exactly. I'm a cart bag guy. I like a cart bag. Little structure. You can carry it, but it can also go in a push cart. Like,
and the deal is you want the space, right? Like exactly. I put a lot of stuff in my bag for better or for worse.
Yes.
And I just want the space. It has nothing to do with like wanting to look or be like a pro. I really like staff bags. You know, the other thing I hate about normal carry bags, I can never get my goddamn clubs out of there.
Right.
Like they always get stuck.
Grips will like overlap with each other.
All the time.
Yeah.
And so whenever I see like Andy or somebody trying to like pull it out, I'm like, hey man, you should get a staff bag. It's like way easier. Yeah, it never gets
they're
stuck.
They're all separated. Technology, man.
Yeah.
It grows over time. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. So at the fan, you talked about, what was it? Tee to Green. You did the Tee to Green show.
Yeah. Well, I produced it, you know, basically sidekicking, Common Man is our big golf guy at the fan. And I've played with him, maybe like around a dozen times in my life, which is privileged.
I was going to say, is it as good as he makes it sound?
Oh, it's even better. Just ask him. No, I love it. It's fun. Really. It really is fun playing with him. Cause he is the same guy off the air that he is on the air. And he really does talk during the entire round. He never stops gabbing. And doesn't matter if you're about to hit your shot or he's about to hit his own shot. He might talk through his own swing. But he has fun doing it. And he is a hell of a player.
Yeah, he's like scratch, right?
Yeah, just right about. I mean, he's like maybe like around 2, 3, 4 handicap now.
Okay, yeah, he's low. Like he's a player.
He's a stick. I mean, he hits it nice and straight, doesn't hit it too far. Like a drive maybe goes like, he says, like a good one, 220, 230. But he gets it up and down every single time.
Yeah,
it's just magic.
Good short game.
Yeah, it would be a great problem to have. If I could trade my distance for a good short game, I'd do it in a second.
It is. I mean, if you're not trying to play, you know, like the pros, right, where distance matters so much because they're also good at their short game. Like if you're just an amateur, like everybody would tell you a good short game will save you from everything else.
Yeah, it's like 70% of your strokes happen within 30 yards of the hole. Yeah,
I mean, you can hit it, you know, in the rough or the trees or whatever, but as long as you can get it back in play and within 30 yards of the green, like, good short game and putting, going to be able to get it up and down for par. It's like watching Patrick Cantlay play. I mean, the dude, like, just grinds out pars.
Yeah.
No matter what.
Yeah.
Like, doesn't really always hit it all that great. When he does, he plays really well, but other times, like, he misses all these greens. Like, if you ever are betting on golf,
yeah,
don't bet against Patrick Cantlay.
No.
Just because you will hate having to watch him play for whoever you're betting against him or whatever, and watch him just grind out pars all day.
Yeah.
Because he'll do it.
And it's a slow process, too.
Very slow
As you
process.
Watch him play.
Yeah. Hey, everybody's got their deal, right? Like, obviously, he's amazing golfer, but
yeah, I don't hold it against him with the skills he's got.
Yeah.
Same with Brian Harman. Like, they get a lot of flack, but do your routine, whatever works for you. If you're going to be one of the top golfers on the planet, like, do whatever works.
I don't know how much you pay attention to the Masters, but did you see that they paired up Brooks with Brian Harman?
Oh, yeah. That's
just because they, like, that'd be so cool to be a part of that team at Augusta to be able to do that. Because one, they're an invitational.
Yeah.
Right. And then two, like, they can kind of, like, that has to be on purpose.
100%.
Like, it has to be on purpose.
It's going to be a great press conference on Friday afternoon once their, like, pairing is done, just to hear whatever Brooks's comments are going to be. Because he's going to have something. There's no way he won't. He's just that type of guy.
Yeah.
Did you hear him get asked about the 59? Yesterday?
Oh, yeah. I posted it on our social channel. It was the best. So I love Brooks. Like, I think Brooks is
he's funny.
Awesome.
He's hilarious.
Yeah, he's funny. He's a great player.
He's a great soundbite.
Have you ever... Do you think you get 59 here? Have you played here before?
Yeah.
No? Yeah, well, I can tell by the question.
Yeah, maybe from the members' tees after 15 holes, I could shoot 59, sure.
Yeah. But. It kind of was a wild question. I wouldn't say it was like...
Why even ask that?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's like completely out of pot. Like, if you would have asked Bryson, I bet you would have gotten a way different answer.
Yeah.
Right? But, like, most guys probably would have had the same, like, dude, what? Like,
yeah.
59? You serious?
Yeah. I love Brooks's, like, just dry, like... Just doesn't care.
Yeah, no, he doesn't.
He just
I love
does
it.
Not care.
Dude, golf, like, needs more of that.
It does.
It hasn't released yet, but Andy did a pod. It was a solid 30 minutes just ripping the tour right now about, like, Jay Monahan and all the money talk and just the back and forth. And then, you know, guys like Rory, and I'm not a big Rory guy, but I will say, like, he really took on that role of being the poster child for the PGA Tour.
Yeah.
And then they kind of, like, stabbed him in the back with the whole announcement and all this stuff. And, you know, now we got to hear about that side. And Rory has every reason to be pissed. I'm like, I'm just tired of hearing about it. Like, we need to get guys like Brooks and Rahm and all them back into the fold and getting, you know, a little bit, just a little bit more into what's actually going on. I hate that we have no clue.
Right.
It makes it 10 times worse.
Right. And it was weird last year. And I felt bad for Rory because, like, I do think that it totally affected his game. Like,
oh,
the fact
sure.
that he had to play that role. And then the way that, like, the Monahan was, like, you know, going to merge Liv and in the PGA. And it was just randomly announced one morning. And then it kind of got swept under the rug over the last couple of years. And, like, the players that stayed loyal were about to be completely screwed over.
Yeah.
I don't know exactly where it all lies now. It kind of seems like the deal has been dead.
We don't know.
For a while.
And that's
like,
no one knows. That's the problem.
Yeah.
So we don't know. So clearly something's happening behind closed doors, but to not know makes it even worse. And I can't imagine being a guy like Rory where, you know, I take my game seriously and I suck at golf, right? Like, but like when I go out to the Windsong or Member at, we play games or whatever, like, it's true. If you got other shit going on in your life, whether it's work or personal, like, it definitely affects your game. Like,
totally.
You're just, sometimes you can tell guys that you're playing with, whether it's your buddies or whatever, like, they're just not there that day.
Yeah.
You know, they got something going on for better or for worse, like, whether they're super happy or kind of down, like, you know, that's why we all like to go out and play golf. Like, it kind of gives you
that
space
escape,
away from that. But mentally, you're still there a little bit.
Sure.
And I like a guy like Rory, who's, you know, he had at that time probably the Ryder Cup going on. He's still trying to win a Masters, kind of in this slump a little bit, going up and down. And then you got that shit going on.
Yeah.
Like, I can't imagine how much it would have affected him mentally when you're having to deal with, like, playing bad and then going to the podium and have to talk about playing bad and you know,
yeah,
the PGA and Liv stuff going on, and you feel like you're this guy that has to do it.
Yeah, he's all out on an island by himself, it kind of feels like, unfortunately, for better or for worse, when it came to that. But like, and the other part of it that kind of sucks is like, it feels like the Liv guys won or are going to win in the future. It's like the guys who stayed loyal aren't gonna reap any of these benefits. Maybe they'll find some kind of way to compensate them retroactively, but like, it's one of those, it's like life lessons, like nice guys finish last. Like, that sucks. Like,
yeah,
I'm a PGA guy, obviously, through and through. I don't tune in to Live, to be honest, but what they did kind of worked. Like, they poached away the PGA, and like the guys that stayed around didn't get rewarded for staying loyal, and that kind of sucks.
It is, like, I'm definitely not anti, like, when I first started, I was very sure, much like,
same.
It's got to be PGA, the way the PGA does it is right, but, you know, like, when I flip to the other side, like, nothing changes until something changes.
Yeah.
My biggest problem with all of it was that it felt like the Greg Norman, Phil Mickelson, like, original talks were about the money.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, it's all money. And what's happened over the last, call it, year and a half, 2 years, like, no, I'm not going to tune in and watch every shot that Anthony Kim hits.
Mm-hmm.
But if it was Tiger, I would.
Yeah.
Like, if it was somebody I really wanted to watch, like, I would. And the thing that they're building, I think, is the right thing for golf. Like, it's sad that the Masters we can't watch on Golf Channel, right? Like, we have to go to Augusta.com, and we only get marquee groups,
yeah,
and we only get Amen Corner or whatever, and we can't watch the Masters until like Saturday, Sunday. You know, like, if this was a live event, right, you'd be able to watch every single golfer, every single shot. It would be live, and that's cool.
Yep.
And so I do think, like, there is some stuff that they're making a little bit better for the game. It's just going to be, can they figure it out between the two
100%.
Of them?
100%. I think that that's the exact right way to put it. And, like, they need to find a way to kind of marry the two. But whatever happened, like, a year ago, like, when they just kind of, like, announced, like, oh, by the way, we're merging together. And, like, everyone who stayed here at the PGA, sorry. Like, you know, that is tough nuggets for you guys. But, There does need to be some kind of deal down the line where the PGA can kind of evolve and do kind of the fun, different ideas that Liv is doing. Because I do appreciate that aspect of it. Some of the team stuff they're doing is cool. Like, the fact that the guys are allowed to wear shorts, like, that's kind of cool. Like, that's a little different. Like,
yeah.
Just little things like that, like, I can definitely appreciate. But yeah, I mean, for me, it's like the importance and like the gravity of having like major tournaments and like the Ryder Cups, President's Cups, Players Championships, TPCs, all that stuff. Like, for me, like, that's what draws me to the PGA and like keeps me coming back. But it's definitely not the like old man, outdated rules of the game that brings me back. You
make a good point. And the thing that I don't think a lot of folks understand, and that I didn't understand for a long time, was not every tournament you watch is PGA Tour,
mm-hmm.
right? Like, mm-hmm. Augusta is Augusta's tournament.
True.
You know,
true.
It's their invitational.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people get, you know, mixed kind of messages or whatever, like understanding, you know, the official world golf rankings and how certain tournaments are PGA, elevated events versus non, you know, like, there's mm-hmm. a lot that plays into that. And I think the strength that the PGA Tour has that they haven't leaned into enough yet is the history
mm-hmm.
and like the tournaments that they have that actually mean something. Like,
exactly.
You hear every single one of these pros talk about it. Like, I'm staying PGA Tour because it gives me the best opportunity to play in the best tournaments against the best people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why like Rahm went to Live, right? Like, I've won my green jacket. That's going to get me exemption to the Masters for the rest of my life.
Yep.
And it's going to get me exemption to all these, you know, major tournaments for a few years. And hopefully by then stuff's figured out.
Yep.
And so I think the PGA really needs to lean into like, dude, like, you're here because of what this tournament means and like what it means to golf fans and what it means to just golf in general and like your legacy. And that's why people stay.
Yeah.
And if you don't care about that, like your Brooks and DJ, like, I've already done all that. Why wouldn't you go get the bag? Like, why wouldn't you?
Exactly. That's why there has to be some solution where they can kind of figure out a way to combine the two to kind of make the best of both worlds, because you don't want to see these guys keep leaving. Like, what if the PGA lost Scheffler? Like, I mean, what if they lost Rory eventually? I mean, and then things kind of stay the way they are. So it's like the PGA will, I don't want to say crumble, but like it could fall apart. Like if this kind of trajectory keeps happening, I don't think it necessarily will. I think that they're going to kind of figure things out and things will kind of become more of a marriage maybe further down the line, where they kind of can borrow ideas from each other or become one entity, who knows. But yeah, you don't want to see things keep getting uglier. And I feel like they've kind of plateaued a little bit. Like it's not been getting
for the better.
Yeah. For the better over the last like year or so. Like, I feel like things kind of felt like they were falling apart, where they were just picking off the top guys. Liv was, but now it seems like it's kind of slowed down a little bit.
I mean, Rom leaving was obviously a big deal. And it'll be, I asked Andy this question the other day. I mean, what if a non-Liv guy wins again? Are you going to see that person go?
Right.
Like if you're Victor Hovland and you win the Masters, like you take the same route that John Rom did.
That's my fear.
There's a chance that it happens. And I quite frankly, I don't know what it would do for the sport. Like I'm still going to watch what's on TV.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah, that's true.
And so it just sucks. Like, all around. It just, it makes it a worse product, and they need to figure it out ASAP, because I do like to watch golf. Like, I'm getting older and it's one of the things that I watch. Like, I'm also a Minnesota sports fan, but aside from being a Packers fan, but aside from that, like, they don't give me a lot to cheer about.
Yeah.
Nowadays.
Yeah.
Big on Anthony Edwards, but like, aside from that, Minnesota hasn't won anything since 91. Unless you're a huge Lynx fan.
Right.
And so
right.
I like to turn on golf and I like to watch my guys, and we've, you know, met some caddies and some people in the industry, and it's like cool to watch them on TV and cool to see them doing well.
That's awesome.
Like Eric Van Rooyen, you know, like we know his caddy really well, and I think he's T1 right now.
Is he?
Like, I love that. That's awesome. Yeah. I think he's 4 or 5 under right
earlier.
Now.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Good for him.
Let's go EVR. Player. Yeah.
He's University of Minnesota. He was the first group today, right? With Knapp.
Yep. Yeah.
I love
Knapp
watching
time.
Him play.
Yeah, and I love Knapp too.
What a swing!
Yeah, like, I was early on the Knapp train.
Were you?
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
We followed him at the Waste Management Open, and my buddies who were just really into golf and golf gambling were like, "Dude, you're gonna love this kid." And we went and followed him, and I did.
This kinda, past Waste Management?
Yeah.
You were there? Oh,
yeah,
man.
So before, and then he won at Mexico, and now he's kind of blown up.
Yeah.
Because people have
he's
seen
mainstream
like,
now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's kind of like the new version of Cam Smith, in my opinion. Not necessarily in their games, but like, you know, they're both rep by Penguin.
Yep.
He's very like cool, kind of like that Cali vibe.
Yeah, I got the flow, the surfer
he's got the flow. He's very like laid back and just like cool. He just is a cool dude.
And he's like somebody, I read this on Twitter, I can't take credit for it, but somebody described his swing as like a perfect mix of John Daly and Fred Couples. And I thought that was like the actual perfect description.
Yeah, like tempo town, but just absolutely full, bombs it, full send.
Yeah, full send, like the backswing is there, but like that follow through, like there's something about it that's just like art. Like there's just like the Fred Couples, you know, like tempo town follow through just looks like a symphony.
Yeah.
And like Knapp's kind of got that a little bit, but with
it's
like a little more
watch in person too.
Oh, I bet.
Oh dude, he pounds the ball. So many of these kids are pounding the ball.
I went to the Waste Management probably 2016 ish, something like 2016, 2017.
Yeah.
Probably I would say top five most fun day of my life. Like we had a couple of my buddies and I out in Arizona, my second home. And we were like, let's go to Waste Management. We got there as the gates open. We rushed to the 16th tee, go up to the green area to try to get onto obviously like the bleachers. And we are in line for probably from like 7:30 AM till 10, 11 a.m. We've maybe gone about halfway through the line. So, like, we're still not up in the bleachers. We've been waiting for, like, 3 hours. We've been drinking beers this whole time, sending out scouts to come back. Like, somebody goes out, get 5-6 beers for us, bring it back to the line. We eventually wound up being like, screw this. Let's go find the guy, like, guarding the entrance and exits for the stands. And so we each threw this guy who was guarding like the downstairs, like the exit to get down the stairs from the bleachers. We each threw him like $25. So like he had like maybe $200 between the however many
eight
we
guys,
had,
whatever,
eight of us. And he let us just kind of sneak up the upstairs portion of it. So we found like a place to stand, and then we were gambling the entire time.
Closest to the pin, or what were you guys doing?
Yeah, so like groups would come through, and we had, let's say, I think there was eight of us. We pick a number, one, two, or three, but you don't know what golfer's going next. You nice. Don't know who's teeing off first. But if you pick two, you got to hope that the guy who tees off second is closest to the hole.
Sure.
And yep. so whoever wins
just completely
like,
random.
Takes the pot. Yep. Totally random. But we were, you know, drinking and having just the best time of our lives. And yeah, I think I walked away like up like $400, but some people left down like $600-$700.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you're up 400, somebody's losing, man. Somebody's losing.
We started off like betting like $5 a guy, and then it became like, the more beers we had, yeah. it was like $20.
Fuck it, $20, and then that becomes like, the standard.
There's 50 groups that come through eventually. So it was a lot of fun. I just remember having an absolute blast.
Yeah, that we go to the Waste every year. Been 5 years in a row now, and it's still one of my favorite tournaments. Where we are talking about eventually, we will have to kind of grow up and upgrade to another tournament. I don't know what it's going to be, but it's still I think one of the greatest sports event out there.
And nothing like it.
Yeah.
Nothing like it.
You can't really explain it to people until they go. And I will say, like, this past year, everybody, they made a big deal about, like, the drinking and, like, the issues and stuff. And I was like, look, I've been there 5 years in a row now. This past year, from Wednesday on, the tournament was out of whack.
Is that right?
Like, yeah. I mean, there were rain delays. The whole course was massively wet. It's really the way that they have it set up, as you know, like it's not super easy to walk.
No.
And especially now with how they've got people like funneling to certain holes. It gets super wet and sloppy, and you had delays on Thursday and Friday, and then it's a massive field, and it just, half the people that are there aren't even there to watch golf.
Yeah.
Right. Like they're just trying to get to 16 and 17.
Yeah.
And so you've got those two holes that are just like packed with half the amount of fans there. And it just wasn't good from the beginning. I don't think it was like out of hand from the perspective of, like Zach Johnson was yelling at people and all this stuff. Like,
yeah,
that happens every year. And it just seemed like this year they picked it up more because, there was just all these, delays and people falling all over the place because it was muddy. And I'm like, I almost fell and I don't drink. The way that it was this year.
And no, it got rowdy for us when I was there that year. Like, there's definitely no question that it was rowdy, but it was all friendly rowdy. Like everyone was like a happy drunk. It wasn't like there was like people throwing beers at people or anything like that. I felt like the kind of is going in that direction a little bit more in more recent tournaments. Like there's been like less friendly drunks, like not as happy of drunks, like maybe there's a little bit people going a little bit too far over the top.
The more comfortable people get, the more rowdy they get.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. And like the first couple times people go, it's a golf tournament, and then now it's just turned into this party. So they do have to figure it out in some way, shape, or form. And where they need to start is not having everybody, when you walk in, have to walk to the same places all the time. Like,
right.
You need to let people disperse more.
Yeah.
The more you just get drunk people in one specific area, like, good luck.
And you open up the gates and you start your morning with a stampede, literally. Yeah. So, like, that's going to set the tone for the day.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, there's got to be a better way to go about this. Yeah.
They'll figure it out.
Yeah.
You talked about Golden Valley a little bit. One of just where we started as a podcast, I kind of told you before, but the whole member guest concept came from, like, private clubs and, wanting to chat a little bit more about specific, country clubs. So I've got like all these flags about places I played and the stories that come with them. And on the topic of gambling, does Golden Valley have a specific game that you guys play? Like, do you have a game at all?
Not really.
Not to put you on the spot.
No. I mean, it's all good. It depends on who you're playing with. There's like the group of older guys. They'll play a couple of different games, nothing like a tradition, like where they have to stick to it every time. There's like a Thursday men's league where the gambling gets pretty good, but no, and I wouldn't say like there's any specific one game that they stick with.
Have you ever played Banker?
I don't think so.
All right, so I'm going to explain Banker because it's been about a year since we last did this, and Andy and I wanted to do it the other day, but it never came up naturally, and now I'm just going to take the opportunity to do it because you're gonna love this
game.
I'm
intrigued.
And when you and I play, one, we need to create a foursome.
Yeah.
Maybe it's Common, Meat Sauce, you and I.
There
that
you
would
go.
Be amazing.
That would be super fun. Yeah.
Bring the K-Fan guys out to Winsong. But
anytime.
So banker on hole one, you're just playing golf, and whoever gets the lowest score becomes banker. If there's a tiebreaker, whoever had the longer putt holdout becomes the banker.
Okay.
And that's the tiebreaker any time for the person to become banker. So say me, you, Common, and Meat Sauce are playing hole one right up the gut, second shot, you know, 20 feet, and you make a 20-footer for birdie, sure. Everybody else pars, you become banker.
Okay.
So the advantage to being banker is on the next hole, you get to set the threshold for what people can play you for. So typically the minimum is $5.
Okay.
But you get to set the threshold, call it the max.
Sure.
So like the max I've ever heard on a hole is 100.
Okay.
That's the most I've ever heard anybody go. And what happens is when you set that high threshold, and you can make it the minimum, you can make it 5, you can make it 10, 20, 50.
Sure.
1,000, whatever you want it to be. You set that threshold, and then the other three golfers that are playing, when they step up, they get to choose a number between that nomination. So between 5 and, let's say, your max is 100.
Okay.
So Common can play you for $5. Meat Sauce can play you for 10. I choose to play you for 20.
Okay.
You follow
you're
so far?
Pretty good. Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, like, 20, if you're the one that's setting 100, clearly you're feeling pretty good. You know, maybe you get a bump on that hole, so you want to, you know,
okay.
Reel people into
I like this game so far.
Yeah, it's a great game.
Okay.
And we're just getting started.
Yeah.
So that's how you set the denomination, and that's how the three people are playing individually against the banker. Mm-hmm. So as the banker, you're 1v3. Mm-hmm. As anybody else in the group, you are 1v1, yourself versus the banker.
Okay.
So now the intricacies come in. So birdies always double. Eagles would double. But on your tee shot, before your tee shot lands, you can double your bet. Right?
That's genius.
So let's say Common's first, and you have set the denomination at 5, and he's playing you for $5. He pipes it, and ball's in the air, he doubles it. So now it's 10. Let's say Meat Sauce goes, and he, you know,
slices it OB.
Yeah, sure. He won't hear this anyway. So yeah, he slices it OB. He doesn't say anything. So he's just for $5. I'm 20 and I pipe it. So I call doubles. Now I'm 40 in the fairway.
I love it.
Common's 10. Meat Sauce is 5. You're the banker and you step up. If you double, all of those double.
Holy shit.
So now you can see how quickly, like, even a $5 bet against you and Common goes 5 to 10 to 20.
Yeah.
If you birdie, it's 40.
And if you eagle,
it'd be 80. So,
I love it.
The last intricacy is on par threes.
Uh-huh.
A double in the air is actually a triple.
Okay.
So, obviously there's 10, easier, okay. You know, it can be easier to make birdies because if like you're the banker and you're like flagging one and three of yours triple, 5 will go to 15, 15 will go to 45, 45 will go to 90.
Okay. I love it.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's banker. That's kind of like the game that we play at Winsong, and I've been burned so many times. I've also had some really good days.
Okay.
It's one of those games where like you can play 17 bad holes, but you play one good one and make a birdie on a double-double.
Yep.
Like you're back.
Yep.
So if you ever want to take that one to the course, maybe we go out and we play.
I love it.
But maybe you can bring that to Golden Valley.
Yeah, that one's really fun. I'm going to have to write this down as soon as we end this podcast so I can remember all the intricacies. But
you won't even need it. You can just go back and record it.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
One of like 10 listeners, you can go back. You can, you know, get the snippet and you can play it.
I'll be with a buddy out of Golden Valley. How do you play again? Yeah. Oh, just listen to this. Just listen to me.
Well, and the biggest thing that you have to remember too is the tiebreaker. So obviously ties happen a lot because, you know, people are making pars and bogeys. Whoever had the longer putt, you have to remember, is who becomes the banker next hole.
Okay. I like that. It's a good tiebreaker.
Yeah, it's a really good tiebreaker. Yeah. It's a good way to do it. You know, you got like two guys putting for birdie, whichever one was longer, you know, it was harder. So
yeah,
you're going to be the banker.
I love it. So then if you both miss, the better miss one would be to miss by like 22 inches rather than like 12 inches. Because then you can be the banker.
If it depends.
The longer putt, right?
It depends. I don't think people do that on purpose because typically whatever you're putting for is going to be worth something.
Yeah, right.
But it also matters because like if you miss and let's say you tap in, somebody else has probably already made, you know, a 10 footer for par.
Sure, that's true.
So like you might be going against somebody else, but if you both miss, there's a good chance one of the other two people have already
drained a longer putt
for par.
Love it.
Yeah.
That's a fun game.
Dude, it's a really fun game. Yeah. I always encourage people, like, first time you play, just play for the minimum every hole.
And yeah.
You're gonna be fine and you're not gonna be too like crazy, but two, you're gonna see how quickly it can add up.
Yeah,
right. Just on a $5 bet,
it
can be like $20 a hole if people are getting crazy. Mm-hmm. And my first round ever played at Winsong. In hindsight, it's so funny to like look back at this because I didn't really know anybody there. I joined because the course is awesome and the things they were going to be doing in the upcoming years that are now coming to fruition. You know, second course, redoing some of the clubhouse stuff. But looking back in hindsight, I was like, what did I get myself into? It was my first round there ever. I was playing with some like veterans of the club. one of my good friends now, his name is Rick Helling, AKA Beef. I was calling him Rich all day, even though his name
is didn't want to
one
you.
Rick to Beef. And he didn't want to correct me, which is very like, for people that don't know him, like can come off as very serious. And
yeah.
I was calling him Rich all day. And I was like, oh, dude, why didn't you like tell me? Like, I don't know who right. these people are. Like, dude, it's Rick.
Yeah.
Or just call him Beef. I'm like, oh, shit. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
We were playing banker against like him and two other guys. And I got absolutely smoked. But I was like, dude, this is my club.
Yeah.
Like, this is where it's at.
That's how you knew.
We got gambling games.
Yeah.
Like, I fit right in here. I love to play for money. I think it's so fun. It makes the game just a lot more enjoyable
yeah.
for me.
Yeah.
Like when there's something on the line, even if it's $5 and a handshake, like
yep.
it's what makes it fun for me.
Yeah. So. My best like golf gambling playing experience was last summer. We went to Sand Valley, 12 of us.
How was it? I'm going for the first time this summer.
Dude, you will love it. You yeah. will absolutely. I mean, you said you don't like walking, so that's the only downfall.
No, hold on. Don't get me wrong.
They have push carts.
We have caddies. We're going to be having caddies.
And caddies.
So I absolutely love walking if
okay.
I've got a cart or a caddy.
All right. Like, didn't
that's
mean to misquote
my favorite way.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's
I had
the
to
way,
establish
then.
That.
That's the way then. And this course is the best walking course ever. Just sprawling, beautiful, wide, green fairways.
So excited.
Rolling hills, like blind, fun approach shots, like really cool layouts. I was there right before they opened up Lido. So I didn't play Lido, but I played Mammoth and Sand Valley. And we did 12 of us buddies, like, from high school, guys that I've been friends with forever. And so it was a 6-versus-6, like, Ryder Cup format.
Nice. Really cool.
Really fun. You know, we gambled a little bit, but it was more about just the competition. And
yeah.
camaraderie was, like, a couple $100, like, into a pot, and then the winning team takes it.
Sure.
So
yeah.
it wasn't, like, all about the money. It wasn't as complicated or as
it's
fun
still just
as
fun
banker.
To have it on the line,
we
man.
Had some side bets, too, but, like, I wish I would have had banker on me at that course because, like, the calling
it's
it in the
city,
air thing,
right?
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's so open. When you hit a good drive, like, you're in position to make birdie yeah. if you're a decent golfer. If you hit it out in the sand, then you're in a little bit more trouble. But I love that's why I love the banker, like where you can call your double money in the air. That's genius.
Yeah,
yeah,
it's great.
Sounds fun.
Yeah, we're going this summer for a event for the Evans Scholar through one of the deals that I'm associated with, and we're playing Sand Valley, Mammoth Dunes, the Lido, and then Sedge.
Oh, nice.
Sedge Valley is the new one, I believe.
Nice.
That's there, so we get to play
okay.
all four.
Okay.
Sedge opens up like a week before we're there, so we're like one of the first groups to play it.
Badass.
It's going to be super cool.
And I will say, too, make sure you make time for the sandbox after
your
morning
rounds. That's the par 3?
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, yeah. We're doing that one night. I don't okay. know when, but we are doing that one night.
There's something about that, man, where it was borderline more fun than the real golf.
Really?
Yeah, because like you're literally walking, and I was picturing more of like a sandy course. Like it's actually not, it's called the sandbox, but it's all grass, like basically from tee box to green. Mm-hmm. But it's like a really short par three course where basically 17 holes, and I would say the average hole length is 75 to 100 yards.
Oh, so you're just hitting wedge.
Yeah, yeah. Like you bring
walking
out a wedge,
a putter,
you don't even bring a bag, and you're barefoot, and like the grass Sweet. Below your feet, there's nothing like it.
Really?
It is absolute magic.
Oh.
And you're there with your boys and like sun setting, what perfect weather. Like there's just no better place
day,
on
man.
Earth. Yeah.
Mental really. Health days.
The sandbox was I would say almost if not just as fun as the real golf course.
I love that.
Yeah.
You'll
have a blast.
To wrap up, cause I know I have to get you home and we're flying. since the Masters is on.
Yeah.
I would like to ask you, if Ryan Donaldson won the Masters and he had to come up with his Masters menu.
Oh, man.
For all the golfers the next year.
Oh, boy.
What would it be?
Okay.
And so you get to do it's typically an appetizer.
Sure.
And then like a starter plate.
Okay.
And then a main.
Okay.
And then dessert. And it doesn't, it like, it's, you know, it's still fluid. Like a lot of the guys will do like burgers and something else for the main. Or something. So you get your app, starter, main, dessert.
Oh man, that is such a good question. I would say appetizers, I would do some kind of like, there's an appetizer that I've had recently at Mr. Paul's restaurant, Mr. Paul's Supper Club. It's in Edina.
Sounds like I need to go there. Supper Club?
It's amazing. Yep. It's amazing. It's like a Louisiana Cajun styled grilled shrimp, like jumbo shrimp, like where they've got this like buttery, savory seasoning on this charred shrimp. And it's amazing. So that's, it's a crazy random item, but that would be my appetizer.
That's the beauty of it, though. Yeah. A lot of the menus are these crazy, just random stuff. Right.
A starter plate, that's like hard. Like, what would qualify as a starter plate? Like a small pasta?
Doesn't have to be. Like, yeah. So, like I think like a lot of them will do, you know, maybe like the salad or, you know, like a flatbread. You know, that's kind of like what I think about starters, like a big appetizer, if you will.
Like, I like a really good, like, wedge salad with, like, if there's like a special dressing on it, like if it's a good ranch dressing or a good blue cheese dressing, just like your run of the mill. It's got to be like a house made dressing.
Yeah,
like it's got to be really good with like some bacon and candied walnuts. Or something.
Love that.
Something like that would be good. Keep some things a little bit lighter. Main course would be like a ribeye, probably like a big ass juicy ribeye.
Sure. It's your meal, man.
Yeah, and then are we moving on to dessert then?
If your main's just a big ribeye, no au gratin.
You got to have some potatoes. You got to have some starch in there. Yeah, au gratin, or some like really crispy hash browns.
Ooh,
yeah.
Like we're talking like the mani, like the mani's. Yeah, like just fully like loaded.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm picturing.
Yep.
Like it comes out in the shape of the skillet it went in on. I love those.
They're so good, man. They're so bad for you, but they're so good. You're eating it, and you're like, my stomach's not going to be good tonight. I don't care.
Right. Dessert for me, I think, like, I have, like, a weird obsession with Häagen-Dazs ice cream.
Ooh. Like, okay. That's different.
So it would be like a chocolate Häagen-Dazs ice cream milkshake.
A milk on top. Sweet.
So, like, it's like, love that. It's not like the vanilla ice cream with chocolate sauce added. It's the actual chocolate ice cream.
Mm.
That made into a milkshake.
Yeah.
There is a difference.
Oh, yeah.
There is a total difference.
I am following you right now.
Oh, yeah. I mean, so I like both, but like there's something different and special about like a chocolate ice cream milkshake. So I guess that would be my menu right there.
That's a good one.
Yeah. Not
really
bad.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I had to come up with that off the top of my head, but ribeye steak, like
that's what makes it good, though.
From a Manny's or the Capital Grill, like the Delmonico.
Yeah. See, I've already started mine, or already did mine because I was talking with my buddy Jared Ludeman. We did like a Masters preview the other day and just put it out yesterday. You know, he talks about gambling a lot and stuff like that. But I then was talking to our content creator, social media. Shout out, Michaela. Thank you for all the work that you do. She was like, you have to tell me when you're doing those, so that, like, that's really good content. People want to hear what your master's in would be. I was like,
yeah,
all right. Well, if I do it again, I'll let you know. So here it is. Here it is. But mine was, my starter. Oh gosh, I'm not even going to remember now. I'll start backwards. My dessert was, you're an Arizona guy. You've been to Steak 44.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Red velvet pudding.
Oh yeah.
Imagine that, but in a massive cake.
Okay. Okay.
So like the red velvet pudding, but in a cake form.
Can't go wrong there.
And then I was going to go butcher's cut for my steak. Have you ever had their off menu butcher's cut at Steak 44?
So. I've only been there once. It was my bachelor party, actually.
Oh yeah. My gosh. It's my favorite steakhouse in the world.
Next time I go back there, I will try that.
Yeah. I'm like same realm as you, like butcher's cut with, you know, some really good sides, types of like potatoes, things like that.
Yeah.
For my salad, I went with a nice Caesar. I'm like a sucker for a Caesar salad.
Yep.
Then I think my starter was for whatever reason, my like favorite appetizer wherever I go is like the hamachi jalapeno, like the yellowtail sashimi.
Oh,
with like the little jalapeno on there, and then whatever like house like sauce they'd put on there.
For sure.
I think like Nobu does the ponzu sauce. Mm-hmm. Other places will put their own flair.
Yep.
I'm a sucker for a good hamachi jalapeno.
Absolutely. Have you been to Billy's Sushi in town?
Yeah. Far too many times.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Billy's Sushi
might be a food podcast here soon.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, no doubt. We go to Sushi Fix in Wayzata because we live really close to there. But when it's like more like a date night, like we'll go to Billy's if we're doing sushi.
There's a infamous photo of my fiance, my now fiance, and I on our 1 year anniversary, and we just ordered one of those big bottles of sake, and we drank the whole thing. Like I, between two of us, drank one of the big. I mean, it looks like it's a gallon, and I'm holding it up, and she's looking at the camera, and I'm looking at the camera, and we're showing that it's empty.
Yeah,
and we're just like. Not there. We're just not there.
That's what happens at Billy's, man.
Yeah, Every time. Billy's so great, and he's kind of like a famous Minnesota guy now. I see him courtside at the Wolves. Yeah. And he's just such an awesome, awesome, accommodating dude. So shout out Billy Shushi. Shout out, what is it, Paul's Supper Club?
Mr. Paul's Supper Club.
Mr. Paul's Supper Club, and then shout out Steak 44, one of our favorite restaurants.
We're food critics now.
Yeah, we could. Maybe we'll start a new pod. We'll do it, Hagel and Donald do food something.
I love it.
We got to workshop
that. It's a working title.
Yeah, it's a work in progress.
Yeah, working title.
Well, we're going to have you back, man. This was great. I mean, it always flies. Mixed a little bit of golf in there.
Yeah.
Your time at KFan, a little bit of food, so... Yeah. Yeah, I appreciate you coming out, man.
No doubt. This was a lot of fun. Thanks for having me, man.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Till next time.
Absolutely.